This is Cody Thompson with a quick note for the listeners. What you're about to listen to is a new segment that Pat and I are doing called Sports Culture. For now, it's going to live in the At The Table feed, but eventually it will move over to its own feed for people who enjoy the content and want more. Thanks for listening.
Welcome to our first ever episode of our new podcast called Sports Culture. It's related to At The Table with Patrick Lencioni, but this is a weekly report we're going to do focused on the world of sports and how it relates to teamwork and leadership and organizational health. I'm joined here by my host, Cody Thompson.
How's it going, Pat?
And the head of consulting at The Table Group, Jeff Gibson.
Good afternoon.
And our engineer, Connor. Hello, as Connor always. Says. And we have a lot to talk about today. Let me tell you, this came about because a number of people recommended that we do something related to sports. And I initially didn't want to because I think sports is probably overvalued in our society and talked about too much. However, it does bring about a lot of interesting topics related to teamwork and culture and provides a fantastic example that most people can relate to. So we decided to go ahead and give it a shot.
Yeah, I mean, we just started another podcast, five episodes ago, so why not start another one? When you came to me with this, I was like, sports? And we don't have to talk about all those books you wrote? Yeah, sure, let's do this.
No, exactly. And we did our first sports podcast about Andrew Luck a week or so ago, and we got great reaction. Some people agreed, some people didn't, but they really enjoyed that. And so we thought, well, there is something about sports that provides a great example, so we're going to go ahead and do this.
And it still will be largely, centered around culture and organization side of things, because this just represents such a great microcosm of how teamwork and chemistry and things play out in a really tangible way, where we have winners and losers and teammates are switching teams.
Right.
And that there's such a great analogous, sort of relationship it has with business. We end up talking about all these things in the office anyway. And so I think the other reason we're doing this is because half the people told us to leave when we were talking about sports. So we're like, we'll go over to the other office and we'll record a podcast.
But actually a lot of the ladies in our office, for instance, and some love sports, others don't. But even the ones that don't love sports find this interesting. And that's why we're doing it, because we were going to call this Beyond the Games, because it's beyond the sports. It's really about human interaction.
Right.
And some people that never knew they were sports fans are going to find this really interesting. Now, speaking of Andrew Luck, I thought I'd do a quick update on that, because it was great to see this week that his replacement, Jacoby Brissett, did quite well. And I think I was wrong. I think they might actually do well. They're rallying around this guy. They have a great team. Sometimes a little adversity is going to go a long way. But what I love about Jacoby Brissett, he negotiated a contract without an agent.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
He does not have an agent. He said, I don't need anybody to do that BS. I'll just go directly to them. They rewarded him with like a two-year, athletes get paid so much. Yeah, crazy. But he's actually quite a really good backup.
He's great.
Could be a great starter. And so he just went and did that himself. They rewarded him for it. He played well. I think a lot of people in the world are rooting for the Indianapolis Colts this year.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Because we hope it goes really well. Now, I also learned something else. I hope Andrew Luck does well in his life too, and I hope he's happy. So we took a take on him during our podcast that we weren't sure that was a great team move.
Right.
He has every right in the world to do it. He's a nice guy. But I think what's interesting is Andrew Luck has become a verb in society. I know that because my wife Laura used it this week.
Oh, yeah. So tell us about that.
So Laura has been doing a Bible study at our church for the last 9 years. Yep. It's called Walking with Purpose. It's for women. It's a fantastic Bible study. But anyway, she does this every year. They just got started. They start with the school year. And she came out of her office and she said, I just got Andrew Lucked. I said, what are you talking about? She says, one of my leaders just called 3 days before the new season or the new series was to start and said, I'm not going to be a leader this year. I've been thinking about this for months, but I've just decided to tell you.
Oh, my gosh.
So my wife, not the biggest football fan in the world, said, oh, my gosh, I got Andrew Lucked.
Turned it into a verb. I love that.
He's probably not looking forward to that becoming a normalized term in society.
No, but what it really means is, at the last minute, you kind of had a change of heart.
Someone for bailed.
Sure. And he has every right in the world to do that, but I think he also has every right in the world to be critiqued, not as a human being, but as whether or not that was a team move.
Sure. Absolutely.
Whether that was a team move. So I think that's an interesting take. So let's talk about other things beyond Andrew Luck. Here we thought Andrew Luck was going to be the biggest sports story of the year, and as it related to teamwork and culture.
And it lasted all of about a week before we had something even bigger to talk about, right?
And that guy's name is Antonio Brown. Now, the thing about Antonio Brown is his house, which will now be his former house, was about 3/4 of a mile from mine because he was playing for the Oakland Raiders.
That's right.
And it's they're located fairly close to me, and a lot of the players live out here. So he is no longer an Oakland Raider.
Yeah,
Cody, what happened with that guy?
I mean, this is a just unbelievable story. That
right.
There's so much information and so many things happen in such a short window.
And from a team player standpoint, so here he is, the best new player on the Oakland Raiders.
Absolutely, no doubt.
They're like going to build their offense around the guy. Tell everybody who's not a sports fan quickly what happened.
Yeah, so you have to start even before this season when he was a Pittsburgh Steeler, right? He was the best wide receiver on the Pittsburgh Steelers. He's arguably one of the best wide receivers in the entire league.
Maybe
and
the best.
Will likely go to the Hall of Fame based on his numbers, that sort of thing. So he is he has some problems with Ben Roethlisberger and the Steelers coaching staff, and he sits out actually a really important game at the end of last season. So game like week 17 or so, if they win, they could be in the playoffs. He doesn't even play.
Right, because he threw a football at his quarterback,
right,
and
right.
Was difficult to get along with. Nobody was sure who to blame.
So he obviously, because he's so outspoken, there's film of him sort of having spats on the field with quarterback, coaches, all that stuff. They decide we can't deal with this anymore. They trade him to the Raiders.
And what a testimony that a team going to teamwork. A team like the Pittsburgh Steelers, known to be great, will cast off not only one, but two of their best players
right.
because of their attitude problems.
Yeah.
And Le'Veon Bell. We won't go into that. So they trade him to the Raiders for nothing.
Yeah, very little.
A third round and a fifth round pick.
Exactly.
This is unheard of for such a great player.
And then they have John Gruden, which in any circumstances, like adding fuel to a fire.
A whole different podcast.
Yeah, whole different podcast.
In the world of teamwork
about
and culture.
Coaching and that sort of stuff. But over the summer, there are so many crazy stories that come out about Antonio Brown. The fact that he went to this cryogenic chamber to try to, like, you know, they do that for recovery. Athletes do that for their muscles. It's like a sub-zero, you know, chamber that you get put in.
He did this in the off-season.
Yeah, he doesn't wear the appropriate shoes or footwear or whatever, and he burns the bottom of his feet, the skin
on
the bottom
of his feet.
He's a receiver. His number one attribute is like running routes and being fast and cutting on a dime.
So he comes to camp and he can't really work out.
Can't run, can't do much of anything.
Because of cryogenics, something right. that everybody does.
So then he, that's crazy enough in and of itself. It gets even weirder in the sense that he starts complaining. The NFL has these new helmets, and he starts complaining that he doesn't want to use the new helmet because it limits his vision.
Right.
And he
and for safety,
catches a football for a reason. Yeah. This is so they, you know, they don't get their heads injured.
Right.
And he refuses to play in the new helmet. So there's this.
To retire because of it.
Absolutely.
And
yeah.
not to play. They finally tell him that he finally agrees to do it.
And so there's two stories that lead into a feud. He gets fined for something he put on social media. The management actually sends him a letter that explains like why he's fined, et cetera.
Because he hasn't been going to practice.
He ends up posting that letter on social media, you know, which obviously if you find me, I'm the first thing I'm not thinking about doing is sharing that fine with the rest of the world.
And I find our employees quite regularly here.
Yeah, you just do it in email though, not a written letter. And then there's this crazy part that just came out over the weekend when all this sort of came to a head, which I don't even know. I don't have a great explanation for, but it sounds like he posted a YouTube video where it was like the cinematic trailer of him sort of working out.
Stuff. He has a professional crew doing social media and production.
Exactly. But what's not clear is that in the YouTube video, which is only a minute long, there's a conversation between him and his head coach, John Gruden, where John Gruden calls to say, hey, look, we want you to play. Let's just play football. You're misunderstood. Gruden actually comes across really, really great.
Pretty good, yeah.
In the audio bit. But what is unclear is if Gruden knew he was being recorded in the first place.
So
and why Antonio Brown would take that recording and put it into a theatrical movie that he put on.
And, you know,
YouTube.
They're talking about whether or not he could actually get legally prosecuted for this because you're not allowed to
record someone. Yeah, of course.
But by the way, we skipped one thing, and that's 3 days earlier at practice, he went up to the general manager, who's kind of a famous guy in the world of sports, Mike Mayock, and screamed at him,
right,
threatened
yes.
to punch him in the face maybe, and used some other inappropriate language. So here's a guy, and they were still going to play him. Finally, all of this breaks out that he said, please release me, and they do.
Right. And
they cut him. They cut their best player. So now two teams in the course of 6 months have let this guy go, even though he's maybe the best receiver in the NFL.
It's insane. And what I'm so interested in is what I'm about to ask you is, so 40 minutes after he's released, he's signed by the New England Patriots.
Well, this is the crazy. This is the thing we want to talk about mostly today. So he, this is a guy that two fairly iconic teams, one of them is very dysfunctional now, the Raiders, but have let this guy go purely for behavior.
Right. And he's clearly, you know, say what you want about whether he's a good football player. He's clearly got some things going on mentally. And I'm not saying, yeah,
emotionally.
You know, yeah, he's just a misunderstood guy with all these crazy outlets of ways he's trying to express himself.
And it's worth saying this. I am actually concerned for him as a human being.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's too easy in sports to talk about people like they're not human beings, like their attitude. But I think he actually has some stability issues. So the one team in the league that has the strongest culture of teamwork and organizational health in terms of this is what we're about, the everybody was saying, well, who's going to pick this guy up? And people were going to the other teams that were dysfunctional, and people were talking about, no, I hear it's the Patriots. And people would say, well, how could the Patriots do that? It is precisely because, and this is the lesson around business and teamwork and culture, it is precisely because they have such a strong culture that this team could even entertain it.
I like that you're going this route.
I'm not saying they should.
Because I almost... well, the question I wanted to ask you is, as the teamwork guy, we had a podcast a couple of weeks ago where we say, stop hiring the wrong people. The one wrong person on your team can derail the culture of the entire team.
We see it all the time.
And you see it in conference rooms with executives. But so here's my question is that how this works? Is that you have such a codified and galvanized culture that you can bring in someone who doesn't necessarily fit that and expect them to kind of mold themselves to that culture? Or there have been a number of podcasts where we've said, look, the culture of this team is why they win. They don't even need the best talent. Then they went out and got the most talented guy who happens to not be a
right.
cultural
I'm
fit.
Not saying, I think this, and the USA Today said it's a social experiment. And I love that they said that, a sociology experiment, because that's what's so fascinating about that. And that's why we're doing this podcast, because this team that won the Super Bowl last year is loaded this year. And yes, if there's any team that could do this successfully, the only one I can think of would be the New England Patriots. The question is, should they take this risk? And here's what makes it even more interesting. This week, they played their first game. Their receivers look fantastic.
Yeah.
They have three guys that are either Hall of Famers or first round draft picks that are doing well. This guy, Antonio Brown, is going to come in and slot in as their third or fourth receiver. Can someone like him handle that?
What do you think culturally is going on within those players? Like, are they looking at, do you think their coach, Bill Belichick,
yeah,
has actually talked to them specifically about the implications of this? Or do you think the culture is just so strong, they don't even need to know?
That's a great question. I don't think he's talked to them specifically. I think he's probably just said, listen, we're focusing on the Steelers this week. I don't even want to hear about this guy. Because every player on the team that was asked during the post game said that too. They said, we're here to talk about this game. We're here to talk about the players we have. They didn't even... So I think that both the culture said to them, don't screw with that. And also they probably had a short message from him saying, I don't want to hear about that. So I think it's the culture.
Okay.
The question is, though, if you're the third or fourth receiver on that team, how do you feel about this? And is this possibly, I honestly believe they're probably kind of hesitating.
A little, thinking, they have to be, right?
Because I don't think they realized how good their receivers were going to look.
Yeah, well, and so you're saying that the hesitation is on the side of the staff and general manager.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the players.
You mean even questioning whether they should have done it now?
Yeah, I think
looking
that
back?
When you see how well, and for sports fans out there, there's this guy, Philip Dorsett, who's fantastic. He's their third receiver. Josh Gordon is back, who's had a troubled past, but he's doing great and recovering.
Absolutely.
Then they've got Edelman on their team. Forget
Hall
about the
famer.
Fact that yep. they have Demaryius Thomas, who's like a pro bowler later in his career, but who looks really good.
Yep.
They've got two rookies that are doing great. Suddenly you think, is this a wealth of... is this just a wealth of receivers? And why would you want to upset that?
This is why I think it's so interesting to ask you this question, which is if there was like a developer at Google who is renowned for this guy's one of the best in Silicon Valley,
right,
or man or woman, whatever, and that person ends up leaving Google because of a cultural fit, they've clearly made some or pissed a lot of people off there and then left.
Specifically around ego and
right,
how they
right,
fit into
exactly.
the team.
Exactly. And so do we advocate for someone that's top talent? Because this is what happens in organizations. You just try to poach talent.
Right.
You don't look for the person who's the best cultural fit necessarily. You go, that person's really talented. Let's bring them onto our staff.
And I'll answer your question.
Yeah.
The answer is heck no.
Right.
Never do that. Hire for fit, train for skill, which is why this is a very risky move for the Patriots.
So why even take that risk? I mean, the leaders that we've worked with over the last 20 years, we would never have advised them to take a risk like that with somebody in that circumstance, Cody.
No, I would say they shouldn't. But here's the deal. One of two things is going to happen, and it's going to be binary. He is either going to go there and act like he has been, and they will cut him faster than his head will spin.
Right.
And I worry about him after that. Or he is going to, because if there anybody can do it, he's going to adapt to the culture and realize, oh my gosh, that's Tom Brady. Oh my gosh, look at all these guys that have won Super Bowls. Oh my gosh, how can I mess with this? And he's going to fit in, and it will be a boost to them. But how much of a boost? I mean, he is that good. Who knows? I think they're going to regret it, but they're the one team that can make it happen. But you know what I want to do right now? I want to step back and say, let's talk specifically about why Antonio Brown is not an ideal team player. Because in our book, The Ideal Team Player, we talk about the three qualities of an ideal team player. So it's too easy to go, this guy's a pain in the butt. But let's go back. Humble, hungry, and smart. Is he humble? Is he focused on others or himself?
Seems the evidence we have would say himself.
Absolutely. Everything we've seen so far. And he's basically trying to build a brand. He's almost made that clear. So humble is not good.
Yes.
Hungry. Does the guy work hard? Now, here's the thing. He works really hard.
He does.
He's a workout maniac. He really does try to get better. He tries to stay in shape, and notwithstanding the cryogenic feet, he's been working out like
a dog. Which he was trying really hard.
He probably was. Yeah, exactly. So it's not a hunger issue. Is he smart? Is he emotionally intelligent about how he deals with people, his teammates, and everybody else? Heck no.
Well, here's an interesting take on that. Is some people are suggesting that he might have orchestrated this entire send-off from the Oakland Raiders.
Well, like, I think at the end
is he pulling the right strings so that he could go to a team that he wanted to be on versus one that's not a contender at all? In which case, if he was smart and hungry but not humble, he could be on our labels the skillful politician, potentially.
Yeah, he was working the Raiders.
It's either that or he's just completely off the rails.
That doesn't mean he might be intellectually smart in that way. But that doesn't mean that he's necessarily emotionally smart with how he's working with his team.
Well, Cody could say everything he did was calculated. But if you do that and then you get onto the Patriots, you don't tweet out a picture of yourself that says business is booming with him sitting on a pile of money in a Patriots jersey. So I'm pretty sure he's not really emotionally intelligent.
That's amazing. Yeah, you're agent. Okay. I'm sorry. I went there, but you're right.
His agent probably is. And his agent was probably like, stop tweeting.
Yeah.
So here's a guy who's hungry, but not smart humble. Or humble.
Mm-hmm.
That means he's a bulldozer. And that means he creates a path of destruction wherever he goes. That's how it seemed what he did at the Steelers. That's what he did at the Raiders. It will be interesting to see if he does it at the Patriots. Right now, given everything I've seen, I would say it's not a good move. But I will be the first to tell you that if anybody can figure this out, it's the Patriots.
Well, and I will say this. If somehow he changes his behavior, he becomes, pretty buttoned up in terms of being in Bill Belichick's organization, and he doesn't stand for any of that sort of stuff. If somehow he can transition from the last two experiences on the Steelers and the Raiders and become a real team player, then that would end the whole conversation about whether talent or culture wins, because if somehow the Patriots organization can reshape him, then
culture is everything.
It's over.
I already believe that. The reason why the Patriots are great, everybody wants to go back and look at their players. No, they do not have the best talent at all. They use the talent they have great. And then they cast off some of that talent and they don't do very well on their other teams.
It's ultimately going to be a test for the strength of the culture at New England, no matter what. Because if it doesn't work,
absolutely.
If it fails, then we're like,
culture.
Not quite as strong as we thought. It's going to hurt them far longer in the long run.
You know, so many people hate the Patriots now. They're like, even my kids were saying this weekend, oh, they're boring. They always win. And they said, how can you like them, Dad? I've developed an appreciation for them in the last few years because they prove culture, even something like sports. They prove that culture beats talent. And it does.
Well, so here's what I want to do, because sometimes it's fun to make a prediction. Obviously, it's pure speculation. But I would love just to get your take on which of those two options is it going to be? Do you think he's going to slide in onto the team, become a team player and succeed? Or do you think he's going to be out of there?
Yeah, well, actually, and there's a third option, isn't there? That he stays and disrupts the culture and hurts the team.
Right.
And I would say, I think that he's going to stay. It's not going to disrupt the culture that much. He might not get very many touches. and he won't be there next year.
Hmm.
That's what I'm. That's my guess. But I hate to even because I hope he succeeds. I hope they succeed. I hope all athletes and human beings do well in what they do. I certainly. But I don't think. I don't think he has. I think he's smart enough not to mess with that culture. But I think he's going to go in there and they're going to throw the ball to him four times a game. It's not going to be that.
It's not going to be
that
very
happy
satisfying.
For him.
Yeah.
I think in the offseason, the Patriots are going to go, we're not going to give this guy another $20 million. We're fine without him because that's what they do. Mm-hmm. So that's my guess. That would probably be the best win-win scenario.
So with this as a sports example, Pat, as you think about some of our clients, the companies that have some of the strongest cultures we've ever come across, a company like Southwest Airlines.
They are not going to take that guy.
They would never take that risk.
But it's a different world. And just to give them a not a pass, but a little bit of grace on this. In the world of sports, there's only 32 teams and a finite pool of talent. When it comes to people that can work at an airline, there's school teachers. You can find great people that they can train to do that. There's just not that many to choose from. And the other thing is another team might get. So it's a little bit different, but I still think it applies, Jeff. So I'm going to give a little bit of grace there, what I will say is you're right, though. The best organizations wouldn't do this. It is possible that too. What's your prediction, Cody?
No, I think that's an important nuance to say, look, there are only 32 teams, and when you have one of the best five receivers, four receivers in the game, do you take a chance? So that does present a little bit more.
Yeah, imagine if there were only 45 pilots
right.
and four airlines.
We got to have a couple of those.
And 70
You're
going
to take a risk.
You might. Well,
a calculated
risk.
Yeah,
you might.
So, yeah, my prediction is, you know, I don't think he's going to make it there. I just, Josh Gordon is a little bit of a different example where he feels like he really wants to
fit on a
team.
He has substance abuse issues, which is so hard.
It's very different.
But I don't think anybody's ever said it was really ego team things. They're rooting for him.
I will say this. If there's any game where he doesn't get the ball thrown to him or a bad throw to him that in the past he went up to Ben Roethlisberger and sort of yelled at him on the field, if he does that to Tom Brady, I can tell you that's probably the last game he'll play there.
Which is funny because Tom Brady, if you ever listen to him, he talks like he's this bookworm. And he'll be like, well, gee, Antonio Brown, we're going to have to get rid of you because you're not being very nice.
I'm sure Tom Brady is going to love your impression of him. He obviously listens to the show.
So. Good news are, sounds like they might be roommates from what you guys told me earlier.
I know. That is so insane.
I know. Well, Tom Brady said, you can stay at my house. Now, granted, it's not like my house where you'd have to see him in the bathroom all the time. He has a guest house. And so the other thing that I find really interesting about all this is that Bill Belichick talks to Tom Brady like he's not a superstar.
Right.
He will yell at
the
guy.
They'll argue in the film room. You'll argue on the field.
He'll
yeah.
call him on stuff, and they'll say he doesn't treat him like a superstar. So Antonio Brown needs to understand that because Gruden really protected him at the Raiders this year. He was constantly making excuses for him. That's not going to happen to the Patriots. So it's going to be very interesting. Very interesting.
It will be.
Hey, I want to contrast all of this with something else I saw this weekend, which was a positive. So I'm watching a little bit of college football. I don't actually watch that much football, though this weekend I kind of did because it was convenient. But Michigan played Army. Okay. Michigan played Army. In the past, you'd go, I wonder if they'll beat them by more or less than 70 points.
Right.
Right? But Michigan, I mean, barely won. And here's the interesting thing. Army is a fantastic football team by any measure. Now, do you realize in the last 12 games, they've won all but two? And the two games they lost were they just had their streak ended by Michigan. At Michigan, they lost in overtime.
And Michigan was ranked number
seven,
I think. Yeah.
Last year, they lost at Oklahoma, who was in the top 10, in overtime. They also played Houston in a bowl game and scored like 70 points and crushed them. So this is a legitimately great team. Now, think about what that means. Imagine recruiting a kid to Oklahoma or Michigan. You're showing them their incredible facilities. You're talking about how you're going to get to enroll in your classes early if they're going to go to class at all. They get food. They get treated well. They might play in the pros. They get wined and dined. I've been to West Point. They're going to show them the cafeteria where they get 20 minutes to eat whatever they're served with a glass of water. If they're late for class or for barracks, they're going to have to march across the quad all weekend. They're going to go to every class. They live in a very Spartan barracks. They're going to have their room checked for cleanliness every day. How in the world, and by the way, and when you get out, you're going to spend 4 or 6 years in the service, potentially in harm's way in a battle, or at the very least in some forward outpost. How in the world do you recruit kids to Army? And yet, they almost beat two of the best teams in the country, and they've won every other game.
It's incredible.
Here's the beauty from a teamwork standpoint. I was watching the game, I didn't realize this, and I was like, hey, every player from Army has the same last name. His name is Army. Not only do they not have their name on the back of their jersey, but they have the word Army.
Hmm.
That's what they put. How awesome is that?
That's great.
Here's a bunch of kids who rarely get on national TV and are working their butts off. You think, well, I'd love my parents or my friends to see my name on there. They forego any individual attention for the good.
It's not about
team.
Them. Yeah.
Now, let me tell you, they probably got outweighed by 40 pounds on every position. And they almost beat the seventh best team in the country on their own field. Have you ever been to Ann Arbor's field? Has 110,000 yeah. fans. So that's something really amazing. And it translates to every field, every, whether it's sports, whether it's business, whether it's school, anything else. When you work together and build a culture of teamwork, you outperform those who can't.
Hmm. Yeah, that's a great example. That's awesome.
Now, there's one last thing we want to talk about to go back to the NFL, because there's one team in the NFL this year who's imploding.
That's right. We just talked about this.
Wow. So the Miami Dolphins. Do you know what's going on with the Miami Dolphins, Jeff?
I saw that some players want off the team.
Yeah, after their first game. So they're in rebuilding mode. So we know what that means. It means, okay, we're going to have a bad year or two, which is okay, but in order to rebuild for the future, because not every team in the NFL has any aspirations to go into the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. There's probably at least half that know there's not a chance in the world. They're one of them, but they started trading off all their other players, their best players. Now, some were for attitude, which I can, but some were just, hey, we can get a lot of draft picks for them.
Yeah, good value or something like that.
Yeah. They lost to the Ravens. Do you know what the score was?
I know that my fantasy quarterback was the Ravens quarterback, and he had a ton of points.
Exactly.
It was 52-8 or 10.
Yeah, I think it was
59-10.
59-10, yeah.
It was the most points that the Ravens have ever scored in a game in their franchise history.
Wow.
And with a quarterback that's brand new. And even the quarterback, they interviewed him after the game. He goes, I had no pressure. I just stood back there looking for my receivers. And at one point, amazing. I heard an announcer go, well, the Dolphins are no longer playing defense.
Wow.
And so
they're like quitting in the game, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
And so it's one thing to go through a rebuild, and the companies can have bad times, and the leader says, here's what we're trying to do for the future. On this team, the player said, I don't want to be here anymore. Oh, that's tough.
But I think it is interesting because there is, you know, this is a strategy. You tank, you know, to get a better draft pick, and you sell off some assets that you have for more draft picks. And this happens right. a lot in the NBA. But there is something to be said for when the leaders of your organization or team give up on the season.
Right.
How do you even maintain any sort of personal investment in that?
Well, and what impact does that have on the culture of that team that might even be left next year?
Absolutely.
You know, that's
exactly.
crazy.
Exactly. So that, what this gets to is that X's and O's and plans and draft picks don't make up a team. I think they undercalculated the impact this would have on the culture, which is far longer term than just tanking 1 year. If you lose the hearts and minds of the people
Absolutely.
In the organization, that you
that's going to be hard to recover from.
Hard to recover. And they have a brand new coach who's supposed to be great. He's from the Patriots, actually. But sometimes the Patriots coaches go other places, and without that organization behind them, it doesn't translate.
Well, what kind of confidence does that instill in the leadership of that organization that they would actually make players endure that? You know, that why would I want to be there next year?
Right. Or even
the
if
year
they
after?
Get another quarterback or another
yeah.
player next
it's like,
year.
So you're just going to treat us like a commodity
yep.
as a player.
Right.
Rather Absolutely. Than a person.
And they have one of my favorite players, their quarterback, Fitzpatrick. This guy has started for 8 different teams in the NFL because he's a great, like the greatest backup and has, but, and
Fitz
so
Magic.
I thought, Fitzmagic, they called him. But I think they're losing the magic there.
Yeah. And as someone, if I'm on a team or working for your organization and you decide, hey, we're just going to kind of hang it up this year and not really try that hard. And, you know, that would be really uninspiring to be a part of. And I've never actually heard of a sports story where multiple players, it's not just one player, it's something like 4 or 5 players called their agents after the first game of the season and said, I want to get out of here.
So they stop being a team now. Right now,
Absolutely.
It's just a group of yeah. individuals who are like, okay, I'm going to do the best that I can for me.
They're going to go through the motions.
Season yep. and just not get hurt and be paid.
What's mm-hmm. ironic is that this is the team, the Miami Dolphins, are the only team in the NFL history that have won every game in a season.
Right.
And they will probably be one of the only teams. There's a few that win no games. And mm-hmm. I don't say that lightly because in the NFL, there's parity and people win some games, but they look like the kind of team that will win none. 59-10 to a team that wasn't known for scoring a ton of points.
Does it? It makes you feel bad for the people working in that organization.
It does.
I mean, I feel bad for the new coach, individuals, the player, not just the players, but the staff, the office staff, the vendors that are working in the stadium. There's not going to be anybody there. I mean,
yeah.
Wow.
There's worse problems in life, but it would still stink to be in that organization. Teamwork matters. Culture matters. And in sports, it's a great way to understand that. So we're going to close down our first podcast. This has been fun. We'll talk to you next week and we'll see what happens and we'll track some of these things. We'll see how Antonio Brown does and how the Patriots do and how the Army football team does and how the Dolphins do. And send us any questions you have, any ideas you have for our podcast.
Cody, podcast@tablegroup.com. That's the best way to get in touch with us.
Podcast@tablegroup.com.
That's okay, right.
Thanks for listening to us. And God bless.